Hi, I'm clear that you are confused. Sorry, I'm not claiming anything, but that is the title of our talk today. Confusion is an area of confusion in psychoanalysis. And to clear this, we have with us today our psychoanalysis consultant, Mr. Himanshu Vaidya. Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
So what is the confusion all about? And what is confusion?
It is said in psychiatry, headache is a headache. Because headache can happen because of so many factors that it's really a headache to find out what is at the root of it and how to heal it. Confusion is a similar kind of entity. Because it means so many things to so many people that it's difficult to make out what exactly you mean when you use the word confusion. And then we have this different types of confusions, and some confusions are very ordinary, very normal, and some are pathological. So we don't know what we are referring to when we use the word confusion. Like the word love and socialism, this word means everything to everybody, and nobody knows precisely what it means. So this is where we are with regard to this word. And therefore, this word is usually avoided. Instead, we use words like ambiguity, doubt, being stuck, perplexity, fugue, flight of ideas. All these are varied forms of not being able to clearly think. And all these are different forms of confusion. If you use this word as a category word, to cover up this category of phenomena. And this phenomena you will find in pathologies so differently diagnosed in DSM. So let us first go into the various meaning of this word confusion, which we use in the normal parlance and we avoid in psychoanalytic and psychiatric parlance. First, confusion can be just ignorance. That I don't know whether to choose LG or Samsung because I don't know how the product actually works. So I am confused with related to that choice, and the confusion is based upon my ignorance. Or there may be a confusion about which medicine to give to a particular patient because the case is complicated and he is not responding to the general prescribed medication. And therefore, two expert doctors are confused. It's a deeply technical confusion. Both of them have quite an amount of knowledge, but the situation is complicated. It can be critical, and therefore, both of them have a confusion of a very different type, a very deeply complicated technical confusion. Then we have confusion which can be related to philosophical aspects. About aspects which are so abstruse and abstract that we know little, and this little we can do to experiment about it. And therefore, in this world of words, there is a confusion. Then we have existential confusion that we don't know how to live and what to do. And we are confused about existential questions of life. We are confused about the human condition. We are confused about what to do and how to live. We are confused about the absurdity, the injustice, the despair, the emptiness, the loneliness of life. And then there is spiritual confusion, where if one is on the spiritual path, what should one do? How does one get into a conversation with existence or God or supernatural foundation of things in order to live one's life? And what coming out of oneself is one's own, and what is it that is coming from a higher power? So all kinds of things are confusions of different type. And it is a very natural human condition to have confusions in all these areas. Not having any confusion would mean omnipotence, and nobody is omnipotent. So it is a very human part of a very human condition to have confusion. However, our narcissism is such that we all believe when we talk to anyone else that I am clear that you are confused.
So, sir, is confusion a pathology or is it a symptom?
It depends upon which category of confusion we are referring to. If we are referring to confusion of ignorance, confusion of technical complication, confusion of philosophical nature, existential nature, these are non-pathological confusions. These are part of being human. Pathological confusion comes in when we have a condition, like, for example, the condition of very high anxiety, one is perplexed, one cannot think. Condition of fugue, condition of derealization, condition of intense greed where one cannot decide, condition of intense doubt where one cannot decide, condition of such high anger that one cannot think, condition of guilt and anger turning on oneself and attacking the chain of linking, not allowing one to think clearly. Condition of unconscious forces, maybe the paranoid schizoid split, or maybe the repressed Oedipus, or repressed homosexuality, or repressed shame, or repressed guilt, acting in such a way that it does not allow us to think as a normal person. And all this can create different conditions, pathological conditions, where pathological confusion is at play. And behind the pathological confusion, obviously there is a set of pathological factors and some pathological events which we study and try to heal in psychoanalysis.
So psychoanalytically, how can one explain the causation of confusion?
It can be a variety of causes. Take, for example, from a Freudian standpoint, it may just be lack of trust built up in the oral stage, which means lack of trust because of the difficult oral stage, or lack of autonomy. And there's some difficulty related to autonomy and submissiveness of the anal stage, or Oedipus or homosexuality working out some way, the Oedipus not being resolved. And all of this can cause issues. The trust factor can cause issues of intense fear of the other, of abandonment, of being exploited, of being dominated. Intense distrust of the other. The Oedipal difficulties can cause in terms of confusion about sexuality. It can lead to, say, delusion of persecution, when homosexuality is repressed and a variety of defenses work upon it. Intense loss of an ambivalently cathected narcissistic object. Again, it can cause confusion. Take, for example, the paranoid schizoid split of Klein-Binoppen. And again, there is confusion whether the object in front of us is all good or all bad. And if it flips very, very rapidly, then there is a complete perplexity, because the object appears all good and after some time appears all bad, and one is confused, what is it at play? So it can be the split being open, where our opinions alternate based upon which pole of the split we are at. Or if the split rapidly changes, there is a perplexity, we are confused what to think about it. Or there is greed, we neither want to let go of this nor we want to let go of that. We want both these things and we are confused. Or there is a severe attack of an introjected parent figure and we are not able to decide on anything. We make a decision and then we fear and we are confused. We have a doubt whether we are correct or not. That if we make a decision and it fails, the parent figure will very cruelly and brutally attack us. So there is a confusion born out of very introjection of very harsh parent figures, which may be at times quite at variance with what parents actually are. So the parents may not be as harsh as the introverts inside are. There may be a lack of good mother experience, no building of containing capacity. And therefore, with any challenge, the whole anxiety builds up, disintegration happens, ego coherence is low. And therefore, a confusion sets in because of high anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
You can get into a second issue of a manic high, which again produces confusion to some people, apart from flight of ideas in some people. And then we have this whole Bionian concept of attack of linking, and I add to it attack of narcissistic rage bottled up. Narcissistic rage, which is created because it is rage at the world, because the world is not my world. It's quite different from what I want it to be, and therefore there is rage at the world. And this also can create difficulties for us. Take, for example, another instance of multiple personalities. That some part of the personality is so difficult that you create a multiple personality, which may be occasional or which may be a permanent habitat. And the person may be confused as to which identity is his real identity. Or anxiety rising so high because of disintegration of ego, because of low ego coherence and low ego strength, that a fugue-like or derealization-like condition is created. That somehow it is so unbearable, either because of anxiety or because of pain or guilt or shame, that you start disconnecting from reality.
Mm-hmm.
And psychosis seems to be the only refuge. So for the unconscious mind in that state, psychosis is a solution to an alternative which is worse than psychosis. There is no way to bear reality. So the sickness is far more bearable than the reality itself. I'm talking about the psychological reality, of course. So these are some of the conditions. Take, for example, the cohesion disintegration of the ego because of low ego strength, because a fragile self is built, not a healthy self is built. Because of the reasons that Kohut lists out. And all of this can lead to different types of confusion. And then take the whole aspect of self-destructive guilt and shame, which puts anger on oneself, more of guilt and less of shame. Shame is less destructive than guilt, but less self-destructive than guilt, but guilt in particular, and in some cases shame also, can generate self-destructive anger and in turn attack the thinking apparatus, the thinking process, and create difficulties and create confusions. So there is a variety of psychoanalytic events and psychoanalytic processes and psychoanalytic conditions which can result in difficulties of thinking, perplexity, different forms of thinking difficulties, to which we give different names in technical language, but in common language, all those can be said to be under a category of confusion. Not that it's the only characteristic, but one characteristic definitely there. So in all these situations, we do find, apart from many things else, what we normally call confusion.
And how is it psychoanalytically treated?
So the treatment is based upon the cause. So if we are looking at the kind of confusion in fugue, there is a different set of treatment. If you are looking at confusion of attack on linking because of envy or rage, narcissistic rage, there is a different process. If we are looking at very rapid shifting of the paranoid schizoid split positions, there is a different type of treatment. If we are looking at greed, it's a different kind of treatment. If we are looking at a fragile self, there is a different kind of treatment. So based upon what we are looking at, what is the cause of it, we have to pick up the school of psychoanalysis and the technique of psychoanalysis. So it may vary from classical Freudian to classical Kleinian to Cohutian to a synthetic approach, where we can start Cohutian first and then take to other schools as the need arises and as you find you can best chronologically structure it.
Not Jungian?
Jungian also you can do. The issue only is that one should be trained to operate with that archetypal mythological process in order to bring focus to this. Because that archetypal mythological method is very good for broad general issues, but it requires quite a high amount of skill to deal with a very precise, crisp, very clearly pointed out issue. So if, let us say, it's very clear that the issue is of shame, then you have to use the Jungian method. Most Jungians I have seen, actually, they go too long by going around in circles, because it's not easy to be efficient and quick in the Jungian framework. It requires quite a bit amount of conceptual clarity and technique dexterity. So this is where you can do it Jungian, but not all Jungians are so efficient.
But I wonder, is a little bit of confusion not healthy and common? My another question was, is it not healthy and a natural process to be, I mean, naturally we as human beings are confused. So is it not a natural thing and maybe a healthy thing?
Yes, that is true. We have to separate between normal confusion and pathological confusion. And a major part of our confusions are very normal. And it's a part of our human condition that the way our mind is structured, we move from ignorance to knowledge. We don't have knowledge as our birthright or something to start with. So knowing is not our default condition. Not knowing is our default condition, and knowing is an attainment. So it is true that having the whole range of normal confusions, there is nothing pathological about it. On the contrary, it is good to have it so that you can evolve from there to clarity. So I think it's a good thing in a normal sense, but when the manifestation becomes pathological, it's a different situation altogether.
So now how does one manage confusion in day-to-day life?
With non-pathological confusions, we just live with them, some of them. Some of them we solve. Some of them are knowledge and training dependent. Some of them we look forward to the leaders in areas of philosophy and spirituality to solve it for us or guide us. And some we enter into a conversation with existence or with God if we are seekers or mystics or on the path type of people. With regard to pathological confusion, we have to go for therapy, because medication is really not a very easy or quick thing for most people. I'm not saying it's not good. It may be necessary for many, right, if the situation so demands. But for this particular category of problems like personality disorders, therapy is almost a must, whether accompanied by medication or not accompanied by medication. But therapy is almost a must. And homeopathy can help a great deal in this particular area. In anxiety, in confusion, I have seen many people report very good outcomes of homeopathic treatment. So this is a combination of our everyday training, our everyday development, our looking up to leaders in the area of philosophy and spirituality, medication and therapy all put together, so that we are able to reduce it to the maximum and use it as constructively and creatively as possible in the non-pathological area. And in the pathological area, heal it as quickly as with low cost as possible.
How would holistic healing and spirituality help in clearing up this confusion?
Both holistic healing and spirituality have a variety of basket full of tools and techniques for a range of difficulties some of which involve this element of confusion. The basket full of technique includes, one would be homeopathy from holistic healing side, then we look at Reiki and pranic healing from holistic healing side, and from spiritual side we have whole range of techniques from visualization to mantra to idol therapy to tantric practices to use of herbs and herbal medication. All these are a basket full of approaches and tools and equipment and aids to really help us in, if not healing from the root, at least support and accelerate our mainstream therapy process.
I guess we have some more time left, sir. So this question has always been bugging me. How important would schema therapy be? I mean, after everything, is it not important to strengthen one's thoughts and one's schema? So in that case, how would it help?
Yes, it can be a very good tool to go into details of it. Let us say if we classify all pathologies into mild, moderate and severe. With regard to mild and the half of the moderate towards the mild range, in that range schema therapy works very well. So whether you take CBT, DBT, REBT, any form of therapy which focuses on the cognitive aspect, conscious mind and the will of man, these techniques are very good for mild and mild to moderate range. For severe and moderate to severe range, there we have to use deeper tools of psychoanalysis, other depth therapy approaches, maybe ISTDP, if possible, coupled with holistic healing tools and spiritual tools. If one believes in it, of course, it's patient choice area. But it's a good way to, that is one part. The second part is, let us say, even if you are dealing with moderate to severe or severe cases, there, one approach that many people take is, you first start with the conscious mind, cognitive approach, the will of man kind of approach. So you start off with CBT, DBT, REBT kind of practices and then give a small gap and then start psychoanalytic, psychotherapy or anything to do with unconscious mind. So in that sense, the first phase prepares the person for the second phase. Then the surface part is done, the rational cognitive measures have been taken. Whatever the will of man can do has been done. Whatever behavior can do has been done. Whatever thought change can do has been done. And now we are at a state of where the unconscious is at play. The conscious has been cleared out to the extent it could be cleared out. So this is one way of how you assimilate, integrate the standardized mainstream cognitively driven approaches or behaviorally driven approaches with the type of treatment we were discussing.
Well, that's wonderful. And thank you, sir, for clearing our confusion. And well, you can write to us in case of any queries at hvindia@gmail.com. Until we meet next time, take care. Namaste.
Namaste.